to turn off your cell phones. Although some of them have some artistic music within the cell phone, but we are not going to discuss this today. Let me start by telling you that some of you know, but we are now celebrating an unusual, for me, historical event of the launching of a new center, the Edmond and Lily Safra Center for Brain Sciences. We just received a $50 million donation from the Safra Foundation to start. Only the beginning, because we need to have a $130 million to do what we really want to do, at least for the beginning. In the future, it will be a billion, I'm sure, because we cannot understand the brain without these huge sums due to new technologies that we need and new inspiration that we shall get today. But in this new center, we are hoping we shall do something that is probably not done anywhere else, and hopefully the university will go with us in this idea. We feel that the friction between cultures, especially between scientists and artists, could give this connection between these two cultures, as C.P. Snow called it, the two cultures. We would like not to make them two cultures, but rather one culture of creativity. And we really believe that people that will interact within these two domains will generate eventually phenomena like Leonardo da Vinci, for example, who did not know that there are artists in one place and scientists in another place. So we are bringing here today an example of what we'd like to see. Of course, it's a beginning. We don't know what will happen in this evening or in this morning, but we'll see. So it's a start. I'm very thankful for the artists who made the effort to come, to Hanoch Gutfreund, who will be part of us. And the structure of this event will be the following. We shall, each one of us, I will start, and then Tzivi Geva, the artist, and then Hanoch Gutfreund, the physicist, neurophysicist, and then Michal Rovner will end, each one presenting his concepts or process of thinking about art, of thinking about the brain, and then there will be an hour of interaction between you and us. And David Wittstum, again, thank you very much, David, for agreeing to come and moderate and make this event an interesting event. And thank you all of you for coming. So I can promise you an interesting event. Be active, think about questions, and I want it to be very dynamic interaction rather than a monologue of the people who stand in front of you. Okay, so let me start with how do we see, at least today, something that is usually not dealt within neuroscience. I don't know if some of you have heard yesterday how scientists approach the brain in a very particular new technologies, you know, shining the brain with specific lights, and so forth, in order to understand the mechanism of the brain to the level of connection, synapses, wires. And eventually we want to connect this level of mechanistic level of the brain to the emergent phenomena, for example, creativity, for example, art. So we don't know yet how to do it, and today I want to just show you a few examples about how neuroscientists are trying all over the world. There are not so many of them who dare to do this connection between art and science, or art and brain, but I will try to say something about that today. So I want to start with a primer about art and brain, just to make a connection, and then I would like to speak about a work by Zemir Zeki in London, who is trying to show us the biological foundation of aesthetic feeling, and Zemir Zeki in London coined the word neuroaesthetics. So neuroaesthetics is now a term, a field, that is trying to understand the foundation of aesthetic feelings in our brain. I want to show you some very new results, trying to show how connectivity within the brain, wires connecting specific areas within the brain, underlies specific phenomena, unusual phenomena called synesthesia. I'll talk about that. And eventually, just an anecdote of some people who are trying to stimulate the brain from the outside in order to become more creative. So these are the three things I would like to discuss with you. Let me start by reminding us all where we stand. So all of it, you started 3.5 billion years ago with this little bacteria which already have this DNA, so there is the material of life in this one cell, 500 million years ago, fish has developed all over the world, and there are, of course, much more complicated DNA and much more complicated structure. Reptiles appeared in the world 300 years ago. Mammals, we, appeared about 200 years ago. Primates, even more complicated animals, 70 million years ago. And the Homo sapiens, who sit now in the audience or talk here, is a very recent event, 120,000 years old. Very, very recent. So a phenomena that sits here, talk, feel certain feelings, develop cell phones, try to understand his own brain, is a very recent phenomena. You're very recent. And of course, the brain has developed of mammals in the last 200 million years from a very tiny brain of about 50 grams to our own brain, very convoluted, very sophisticated, as you know, of a kilogram and a half brain that does all these miracles. But again, the print, sorry? But that's too much, isn't it? Let's try. How about that? It's not, anybody is an expert. So it's either all or none here, you see? Okay, I don't think it, I won't have many of those, but if there will be, okay, you want to see your brain, fine, let's do that. So this is a kilogram and a half brain, tissue, about 10 billion neurons, nerve cells, more other type of cells within the brain, glia cells and connective tissues. So it's a kilogram and a half that was developed within the last 120 years to this amazing capability within a brain. If you want to look just at one cube millimeter of a brain of your cortex, you will see something like that. If you dive into this 1 millimeter cube of a piece of a brain, you will get about 1 billion connections and 5 kilograms of fibers. So within 1 cube millimeter, there is a huge connectivity, and now you are really diving into a piece of 1 millimeter cube, a simulation that we do, and you can see how it really looks, this amazing wiring diagram of this inside of your 1 millimeter cube. You have about total, so this 5 kilometers is 1 millimeter cube, but you have about 5 million kilometers of wires within your brain. 5 million kilometers of wire is doing what you do now, listening to me. Okay, so maybe I can turn on the light now. Can you see? Yeah. Okay, so this rapid development of brain weight until the last 120,000 years brought us to this point. For example, Einstein had, just to make sure that you don't think that the weight is the most important thing, Einstein had a weight of 1 kilogram and 200 grams, so his brain was here. For example, my brain is around here. Some of your brain is somewhere there. And so it's not the weight, but it's the connectivity that makes us what we are. And in the last, as you know very well, the emergence of art is very recent, something on the order of 30,000 years old. The emergence of agriculture is even younger, 10,000 years old. The emergence of science is even younger, and the emergence of neuroscience is even younger. So the solid neuroscience that we are going to talk about today is only 100 years old as a discipline, as a serious discipline. So all this phenomena is amazingly new. And of course, the question is, what happened to our brain that succeeded in generating these new capabilities, not to speak about language or writing, but art? Okay, so art started on this about, as I said, about 20, 30, 40,000 years old. This is very well known, this Venus sculpture. And of course, you all know, and if you don't, you really should visit south of France or north of Spain to see this amazing, absolutely amazing art on the caves in south of France, where these prehistoric people sat with a torch in complete darkness, just with a torch, imagining what they should do on the wall, not bringing these bisons or lions inside and drawing it on the wall. So imagery, certainly the capability to image something that does not exist, is a new phenomenon of our brain. We don't know if monkeys can image another monkey, for example. So this is Shavoke, which is the oldest, considered to be the oldest today. This is Lascaux, the most well-known that is closed now, and so on. So art. So these are the heroes, these are the pioneers that are really starting, and I will tell you a few words about some of them that are really trying to make this connection between neuroscience and art. And as I mentioned, Samir Zeki here, who wrote this book, Inner Vision, which you should really read if you're interested in the field, is the one who coined this word neuroaesthetics. And I'm going to talk about this neuroaesthetic, but there are others. Ramachandran is fantastic. You can see him in the television a lot. Jean-Pierre Changeau is another one, and so forth. So these are really the pioneers of the field of neuroaesthetics. And all of them basically, of course, want to do this. And I think Hanoch Gutfreund will try to tell us something about the connection in terms of the conceptual connection of what artists is trying to do, what scientists is trying to do, and see whether there are links in the way we work, in the way we think, and then whether we can communicate about these methods that we are using. Just want to mention that people like Miró said art is the attempt to find the alphabet of the mind, the alphabet of the mind. I like actually this word very much, the alphabet of the mind, because neuroscientists, of course, attempt to find the basic laws of the brain. We are not going to replicate brains in terms of understanding. We want to find the alphabet, the essence, the basic principles. So already in that sense, you can see that artists and scientists are trying to find some alphabet, some basic principles of our brain. But Hanoch will talk about this more. Of course, this character, Picasso, said something about art is the lie that reveals the truth. And of course, science is the lie that reveals the truth, because when I write an equation, it's not a truth. It's a symbolic representation of the truth. It's a lie in terms of Picasso. Okay, so let's start with the work of Zeki, Zamir Zeki. What Zamir Zeki was trying to do is the following, conceptually. He took people, 300 people actually, showed them pictures on the screen and asked each one of them to say whether or to mark whether this painting is beautiful, ugly, or somewhere in between. So it was a personal choice of each one of the viewer looking at the different paintings. So it could be abstract, it could be figurative, it could be Picasso, it could be Van Gogh, many pictures. Each one marked these pictures according to his own taste. So already Zeki, for these 300 participants in his experiments, he knew a priori already which painting is ugly for you, which painting is beautiful for you. So this was the beginning. Then he put people into the magnet. I'm sure you know that there is this magnet, functional MRI. You can lie down in the magnet, it's non-invasive, and you may think about things. You may think about your mother, you may think about moving your hand, you may listen to Beethoven, and you can image the brain while you are doing this operation. For example, in this case, when you look at faces, there will be a face on the screen while you lie in the magnet. Suddenly there is a face, and you see this area is lighted up. When I say lighted up, this functional MRI measures oxygenated blood flowing in this area, and we think that this area, because it is electrically active, it demands more energy. Because it demands more energy, there is more oxygenated blood flowing into this area, so you may characterize which area is doing what. So when you think about your mother, we know which area in your brain is now thinking about your mother, or any other function when you're in love and so forth. We can image your brain when you do some function. So in this case, Zamir Zeki took your brain, the brain of his participants in his experiment, and he was now showing these people in the magnet, on the screen, they were lying down, they showed in the screen the pictures that they were shown before. But this time, he was looking at the brain of these people, I almost say patient, but they are not sick people, they are people like us. He's looking at the brain of these people, and he's trying to find out what's happening in this brain. And he was asking the two questions. Are the brain areas that are consistent active across subjects, all of us, are the specific brain area when they perceive painting as beautiful? And the same is ugly. Is there some beauty area in the brain? Is there some ugly area in the brain in all of us? each one with his own preference of beauty and ugliness. So of course, when you do this thing and you show, for example, portraits, there will be regions in your brain that are sensitive to portraits. Face area, areas that deal with faces. If you look at landscapes, let's say trees and so forth, there will be areas that are specifically activated for landscape and so on, still life and so on. So these are specific areas that deal with the sensory input. But he was not interested in these areas. He was interested in the areas that are related to your own preference, whether it's beautiful or ugly. And I'm not going to go over all the details and the technical details here, but eventually he found some quite amazing things. He found that actually it doesn't matter if you like it or dislike it, if you think it's ugly or beautiful, there are only two areas in all of us that are lighted up when it's either very ugly or very beautiful. So, and these are the two areas. You don't need to remember the names, but this area is somewhere deep inside here, from here, and this other area in the motor cortex is here. So these areas, independent of the type of painting, whether figurative or abstract, when you like it, these two areas will light up in this magnet, and if you hate it, these two areas will also light up. The only difference is the proportion of activity in these two areas. So when you hate something, when you don't like something, the motor area, this area, will light up stronger, and this other area will light up relatively weaker. And if it's the opposite direction, when you really like something very much, this emotional area in the brain actually will light up stronger, and this motor area in the brain will light up weaker. So I can now look at your brain. If I knew, I don't need to know anything. When I now look at your brain in the magnet, and you look at things that you like or don't like, I can tell you, I can read your thoughts. I know whether you like it or not. So that's one advance. It's small, but apparently all of us have some similarity in the places in the brain that deals with beauty and ugliness. Of course, you can ask me question whether it's only visual, what would have happened if it was Beethoven, and so forth. Do you like Beethoven or not? Is it the same area of beauty of music or beauty of other aspects? This he didn't do, but at least in terms of visual arts, we know that there are these two areas that process this visual art and give it a value. I don't like it, I like it. So this is the areas, and you should know from now on that when you go to see Michal Rovner or Tzvi Geva, beautiful art, and you like it, and you like it, this goes down in activity, and this goes up in activity. Okay, so that's one aspect. I want to show you another aspect of brain research, very recent, and that's the following. I don't know if you are aware of the fact, but if you look at all these people, and these are just examples, of course, of Feynman, the great physicist, Nobel laureate, of Scriabin, the composer, of Vladimir Nabokov, Kandinsky, and Schoenberg, these people were all synesthetic. Synesthesia is an amazing phenomena, and it is like this. For example, if you read what Feynman is saying, he said, so synesthesia is a neurological phenomena. It's not a sickness, but it's a neurological phenomena. We know that some people, actually about 1 out of 20 people is synesthetic. That's what we know today. And for example, when you read what he said the following. When I see equation, I see the letter in color. I don't know why. As I'm talking, I see vague pictures. It's very hard for me to read from here. I see vague pictures of a Bessel function with a light 10 J. So whenever you see the letter J, it seems to be light 10. It's, let's say, yellow. Slightly violet bluish when he looks at N, it's always blue. He can't avoid it. It jumps, this blue jumps. And dark brown when I look at S flying around. And I wonder what the hell it must look like to the students. So this is just one example of a synesthetic person. He cannot avoid, it's automatic. When you see the letter A, it's yellow. When you see the letter B, it's green. It's automatic. He cannot choose it. It's automatic. So all these other people were synesthetic. One of the most well-known synesthetic, you can't hear it, can you turn on? So another well-known synesthetic person was Schoenberg. So when Schoenberg looked at a color, let's say green, it bring a certain sound in his ear, in his brain. He could not avoid that Do was black, that C was green. So in his case, the synesthesia was connected between sound and color. The other one, synesthetic friend of his, of Schoenberg for a period of time, was Kandinsky. Kandinsky sat and heard these three piano pieces of Schoenberg around 1909, actually 1911. He looked at it, he drew what he heard, and Kandinsky was one that when he heard a sound, it was immediately connected to a color. Okay, so that's what happened from this, and that's what Kandinsky said. He said, yellow is disquieting. This is, by the way, the result of listening to Schoenberg piano piece. So he heard piano piece of Schoenberg. This part of the musical piece was black for him. This part of the musical piece was yellow for him. And he created this piece of art, and many of them, as a direct result of listening to sounds. So he see colors when he heard sounds, and this is what happened. So this is another type of synesthesia. So Schoenberg was synesthetic because when he saw something, there was a music in his head. Kandinsky was the opposite. When he heard something, there was a color in his head. Okay, this is another well-known synesthetic person, Scriabin. You may know that he wrote this Prometheus poem due to his synesthesia. We don't do it today, but there was a time when they did this symphony with colors and smell coming out of the auditorium, so it was not sound anymore, it was all the senses. Actually, synesthesia means the merging of the senses. So he was really a very synesthetic person. Okay, so after all that, and we did not know until very recently, what is the source of synesthesia? We do know that synesthetic people, many times, are very creative people, as I showed you before. You can be creative and not be synesthetic, but many of the synesthetic people are very creative. So the question was, what can I say about the brain of synesthetic people? What's happening in the brain of synesthetic people that are doing this amazing connection, automatic, that cannot choose this connection, color, sound, letter, color? What's happening in the brain of synesthetic? Recently, it's a very recent technology. We can image the brain. This is MRI. This is not functional MRI, but this is MRI. But it's a special technique of MRI that allows you, it's called diffusion tensor MRI, which allows you to see connections, fibers, connecting one area to the other. So this is a real image of a living brain sitting in this other magnet. It's not the functional MRI magnet, but in another magnet, you can go to the hospital and they MRI your brain. This is another MRI technique, and you can see which area is connected to which area. For example, this is the corpus callosum connecting one area of the brain to another area of the brain. So you can ask yourself today, in synesthetic people, let's say from colors to letters, is there a strong connection? Are there very strong fibers connecting the area of the letters to the areas that deals with the letter in the brain? We know which area deals with the letters because we have functional MRI. So when you see a letter, I know which part of your brain deals with letters. And I know which part of your brain deals with colors. But are they connected strongly? So we could not do it until last year. And in last year, we started to get maps like this, which tells you in each one of your brain, we can now know which area is connected very strongly to which area. Of course, we can use this technology, for example, in Alzheimer's disease. We know which area is starting not to be connected to another area during Alzheimer's. So we have this technology to look at fibers, at connectivity in a brain. You can ask, for example, what changes in the connectivity when you learn something. I don't know if you know, but taxi drivers in London, for example, has a huge connectivity within a specific area called the hippocampus. We can use this to look at taxi drivers' hippocampus and see heavy connectivity there because they need to remember all these thousands of streets in London. Okay. Some people think, by the way, that this creativity of synesthetic people is the source of metaphors. Because in metaphors, you connect things that seemingly are not connected. For example, cheddar cheese is sharp. Why sharp to a cheese? Or we wear a loud shirt. Shirt is not loud usually. But you use these connections in the language, and it could be a reflection of some synesthetic property in the brain, maybe. Okay, so very recently, a very important paper in Nature Neuroscience, this is one of the best papers in the field, people did the following. They imaged the brain with using functional MRI to see what area is active. The yellow area is active when you look at colors. The blue area is active when you look at letters. And you ask yourself, are these areas connected strongly in the case of synesthetic people? And indeed they found that physically there is a stronger connection in people that claim, and you can also see it in their behavior, that letter is always red, A, B is always green, C is always yellow. There is a strong connection here. This is a new result which shows you that there is a fundamental neurological basis to the phenomena of synesthesia and maybe to the phenomena of creativity. It's good to be connected when you want to be creative. That's clear. Okay. So this is just one example of synesthetic people, and this is a test by Ramachandran. So if I show you this, nothing jumps essentially to you, but if you are a synesthetic person and H is always connected to red, you will see that. So when I put on your screen this thing and you are a synesthetic, H is red, immediately you see this triangle of red. This will be a test that you don't just claim that you are synesthetic, but your reaction time to the H is much faster than in a non-synesthetic that has to look at some structure here and you don't see some structure. And he sees immediately a structure because the red pops up. Okay, and these are the two areas that I mentioned before, the letter area and the color area in the brain that are connected strongly in the case of synesthetic. Okay, finally I want to conclude this part by showing you a crazy experiment. And this was this experiment actually done with Oliver Sacks and an Australian fellow called Schneider in Sydney. They were influenced by this amazing thing. As you know well, there are these savant autism children. In this case, they were very well known. Nadia, who at the age of 5 could draw amazingly complete, you may call it artistic or not, that's a question of debate whether it's an art, but you can see that she did this and Leonardo da Vinci did this. She's at the age of 5. And you know, this special autistic, the savant autistic children can do amazing things like, you know, sometimes multiplying numbers or do some amazing calculation. They know to do one thing, but extremely good. So something is special in their brain. We don't know yet what, but something is special in the brain. So Oliver Sacks and this guy Schneider, and this is a paper, an article in New York Times, but you can also see now more and more papers of this sort. He said, maybe I also have in my own brain, Oliver Sacks said, amazing capabilities, but it's shut down, it's inhibited. I need to do what I know to do, but these other creative areas are not active. Let's try to activate my brain. So here you see Oliver Sacks using this new technology, relatively new technology, the TMS technology, transcranial magnetic stimulation. You can put this magnetic stimulation, as you can see, on the skull, it's non-invasive, and inject electromagnetic pulses into specific area. So Oliver Sacks was doing it here for 10 minutes, and he compared his drawings of cats before doing this stimulation and after doing this stimulation. I didn't bring you the drawings of the cats of Oliver Sacks, but he's a very poor artist. He doesn't know to draw, and the cats looked very bad in the beginning. But after 10 minutes of stimulation of the frontal cortex, the cats became beautiful for a few minutes, and then it faded away, and it was again the old, not interesting cats. So somehow in our brain there are things, there are capabilities, there are talents that we are not exploring, that we don't know about them, and apparently this machine, if we believe all these amazing things, this is very new and it's very controversial, then you may become, for a minute, maybe Leonardo da Vinci, or Michal Rovner, or Tzvi Gebhard, and fade away. You may come to us for an experiment like this. Okay, I want to end by saying it is amazing what we are trying to do. I'm sure we shall hear about Einstein more from Hanoch, but we have to remember that all these descriptions that I gave you is very mechanistic. This is connected to this. It doesn't give any meaning to what we do. It doesn't mean anything until we are starting to deal with meaning, which is a word that we have to discuss at another time. What does it mean, a meaning? But I think Einstein said correctly that we can describe everything scientifically. For example, Beethoven as the waves of pressure in our ear, but it will be without a meaning. It will make no sense. Beethoven is more than just this mechanical impact on my ear. But we'll discuss it later. Thank you very much. Okay, so now it's the real artist who is coming, Tzvi Geva. I'll give him the podium to present his work, and then we'll continue.
Good morning. It's okay. I know nothing about the brain, so maybe I know something about thinking about art or about the process of thinking beyond making art. And so I'll try to speak a little bit about it. I want to show, to focus on the last big project I did in the Tel Aviv Museum, which called the Tel Dvarim, or Mound of Things. It was a kind of retrospective show, which just closed in February. And I want to make a presentation and to show something about the process that led me to this show. First, I want to just to start with the very important point that I think that every artist deal with when you start to make artwork or especially painting. I'm a painter usually, and the dilemma that I always think about or start with is the dilemma against the white canvas. When you stand in front of the white canvas and you have to start every day again or every week, and then you ask yourself, what can I do or what I want to do and how to do it and what I have in mind today. And this dilemma is never solved. I mean, you make one painting and then other, and during the years, you every day you start again with same problem. How I start, what I have in mind, what I want to say or to do, and I think that's a problem. It's a very important problem, and I think from my experience that it's divide artists to two different sections. There are artists who try to solve this problem before they start making the object itself. I mean, those artists just make drawings or sketches, and they think about it, and when they solve the whole ideas about this specific work, they're going and they produce it. So there is a division between the process between and between the process of doing the piece. There are other artists, which I identified myself with, which take this problem and make it or put it in the center of their work. In my experience, for example, I found myself that the problem or the question about what I want to do, that's the main project that I want to deal with. So the whole process of doing the specific painting is process of dialogue, inter-dialogue that I'm doing with myself and with the material, with the paints, with the other kind of materials, when I try to understand what I want to do here, and during the process it became clear more and more. All the thoughts, all the doubts, all the questions about the painting, that's the subject matter of the painting in this, from this point of view. I have to bring a quotation before I continue of a great artist, of Richard Serra. He is maybe the most important sculptor now. And he said once he came to Jerusalem, he gave a lecture in Bezalel Academy, and he said something like this: I never start building with a definite intention. I don't work from previous ideas or mathematics theory or plans. The structure are results of experience and creation. I never describe or illustrate. When I start, I don't have definite aim that I want to achieve. My work is not limited by a pre-formulated definition. That's what Richard Serra said. He's doing a very big metal sculptures, and I just choose to use his words to start with, because what I want to show now is I want to show my process, and I want to show how I deal with. I'll start with a presentation. I want to show more than to talk. I'll start with one specific painting, and maybe just a moment. That's not fair. Okay. Okay, I start with this painting, this specific painting, but I want to, after it, to make an analog, or to make an analog between this painting and between the way how I organize my retrospective in Tel Aviv Museum, because I think that there are similarities between the structure or the organization of the piece. This specific painting I did in 1992. It was the first painting in my retrospective in Tel Aviv Museum, and you can see many different things here. By the way, it's not collage; everything is paint. Is divided by very strange and different pattern which divide the space. And I brought together, you know, I on the surface, or the cover story is kind of landscape. I called it disturbed landscape, because it's landscape that you disturb by many pieces of different images. And it's bring together, it's kind of heterogenic landscape, which bring together different images that I dealt with before. For example, this painting, which I call the Balata or Terrazzo, it's done in the beginning of the 90s, And that's one example of the element or image that I use a lot. I did hundreds of Balata paintings. It looks very abstract, but it refers also to Balata tiles, which is very typical to our environment. This is another image that I dealt a lot, and I'm still doing it. I call it the keffiyeh. I have a big series of keffiyeh paintings. This is one of the first ones. It's I start to make keffiyehs in 88, and I continue until now. This is another example of the keffiyeh painting. By the way, this painting, this specific painting, was also in the show in the museum, and it's not on canvas. It's done on nine black boxes. This black archival boxes, which I found. I put them together and I paint the keffiyeh on it. The black boxes also bring to mind the idea about the black box, about the memory, about the box who keep the memory. This is another terrazzo painting, a very big one. It's about 180 centimeter high and more than 5 meter large. This is another example. You can see in the terrazzo, there is a structure, but inside you can find many different details of different drawings, different images that just exist, and so you can see them through it. This is just an example of wall with a few bird painting on a founded object. Bird is another image that I deal a lot with. This painting is bring us the other motif that I deal with, is the flowers or the thorns. Here you can see one of the biggest paintings of the mountain-like, which was in the show. We will see them later. This painting also, it's one from a big group of paintings that I called grids or windows-like, which I did in the mid of the 90s. It looks like window, in same time it's very abstract. It's referred to the composition of Mondrian and the geometric composition of the grid, which is the most emblematic pattern of the modernism. This work is just represent the other side of my works, is the three-dimensional works. I call this project Lattice. I built it, it's by Iron, and this project show here in the station Power in Tel Aviv, and it's about 35 meter long, different pattern of lattices. I come back to the first painting just to show that this heterogenic painting includes many different details from other images that I did before in separate, I mean in different different images as different situations. I go to my studio because when I started to think about my retrospective and about the show, I thought about what I want to show and how I can organize everything together. Now, this is one picture from my studio. My studio is kind of a holistic space. It's more than studio. I not only produce paintings there, but I am also a function as collector. I collect many different objects. Part of them are not art, but I look on them and I put them on the walls like big library or archive or kind of archival of sources and origins, which I sometimes use in my works. And it's very important the way how it's hang and the whole collection. This collection, for me, it's kind of background to what I'm doing, and I use it later in my specific works. When I started to think about showing the museum, I wanted to somehow to bring this situation to the museum, or to produce it in the museum, in the space of the museum. Then later I understand that I can't do it because the museum is very big, the space in the museum is too big, and I can lose the intimacy of the studio. So I just kept the structure of or the organization of the whole this wall as kind of metaphor to what I want to do, and you will see later how it's find the solution in the museum. Now I show you a few pictures of the plans that I did to the museum. I use a program, a specific program, three-dimensional program of architects, and I work with architects, and I try to bring things together and to see how can I bring together or make one holistic work from a work that I select from 30 years of doing art. Those are few of the plans that I produce before the show. Of course, it's not the exact results of what I did at the end, but it just show you how I started to think about the whole thing. The showing the museum, I came to the idea that I want to make it as one big piece, which use in my works, I can put there maybe 50 works out of 1,000 or more than 1,000 works that I produce, and I have to make selection, but I brought together works, paintings from different times, different ages, and I want to relate to everything, like big space, like kind of mental space. Mental space, I mean space that you come in, or kind of environment. It's not only a painting show that you put painting one after the other, but you come inside the space, the viewer, when you come to the museum or to the space you cover by the, you find yourself inside situation, very specific situation. Sometimes it's few different situation, and the whole thing make kind of mental feeling or mental situation, which work as analog to the space or the consciousness space. Here are the pictures from the real show. I just choose few of them just to show you how it's look at the end. And when you come in, that's what you find. This is one of the mountain big paintings. You can see in same time the relations between this painting, which done in 2008, to the bird that on the other side, which I did in 81. That was the first the most earlier piece in the show. And there is a keffiyeh painting from 2001 in the back. Here, for example, is one of the walls of the museum. I put together different paintings. All of them relate to the pattern of the terrazzo, but they are from different times. The right one, that's the painting we start with. The second one is from 2005, the third one is from 2008, so they are from different times, same motif on same wall. Those are the mountains. Here is a panoramic view which show together the big landscape or the big mountains with the wall of the swans and the birds. Now here you can see the structure of the installation. I mean, here I put them in different kind of hanging, different concept. It's very similar to what I have in my studio. or what I have in my mind. What was very important for me here was I tried to mix works, to bring together works from different times and to make a new interpretation or new way of showing them together in the situation in the museum. And also I wanted to make relations between different group of work, of paintings. For example, the Ixos paintings, which you see there, relate to the mountains, which hang on the other side of the space. Here, for example, the bird on the left is from 81. The other painting with Aisha is from 86. The Narcissus in the middle is from 90. The two paintings, black paintings on the right side, are from about a year ago. Those keffiyeh paintings from different times. On the right side, the paintings from the 1990, the other from 2002. Those are two big terrazzo paintings from the beginning. I mean, I did them in 1989, and they are of course the old version of the terrazzo painting. The Greek painting and the X painting are from 95 and 97. Painting in the middle, the keffiyeh painting, I just want to say something very short about it. I did this painting in 94, and I spent time in New York, and then I was affected by the architecture and by the abstraction of the American tradition of abstract, and you can see kind of grid in the back of the fence of the keffiyeh, of the pattern, and so I start here something that after it developed and became an independent motif in the right side, the grid painting, and I did the keffiyeh on it. So there are a few different patterns that that I put one on the other, and so this specific painting is kind of transition painting. This is the last painting in the show, which just closed the show or blocked the space at the end, the other door, and relate to the structure that I built down. I didn't relate to it now, but it's short time, so I can't. The last thing that I want to say, that's what I wanted to show here in the presentation, is the similarity or the analog between the individual painting as kind of collecting images, thinking and feelings and memories, and the whole show as kind of a same organization or something very big that happened in the space, but somehow similar or transparent to the first painting, and to think about everything as kind of a space of consciousness or space of thinking. How someone think about paintings, how someone think about images, how you bring it together, how it became a one holistic piece. Thank you very much. before we get my presentation up on the screen, let me just tell you that Tzibi started his presentation by saying that he knows nothing about the brain. He doesn't know how much he knows about the brain. But for that, we have to engage in a dialogue. And that's what I'm going to talk about. Dialogue between artists and scientists. Now, whenever we talk about art and science, one usually... הם רוצים גם לראות אותי, לא רק את זה, נכון? כן. All right, whenever we talk in the same context about art and science, I mean, it has almost become a ritual to quote Albert Einstein. And what one usually does, one quotes his saying that the most beautiful thing that we can experience is the mysterious. This is the source of true art and true science. But I would like to quote something from Einstein, which is less known. And that is, after a certain high level of technical skill is achieved, science and art tend to coalesce in aesthetics, plasticity, and form. And Rabindranath Tagore, and here this is a famous picture when they met in 1931 in Einstein's summer house outside of Potsdam. For me, art and science are expressions of our human nature beyond our biological needs and of basic value. I don't think that I quite agree with that, because if it is part of our human nature, then maybe it is not beyond our biological needs. And if you remember what Idan just told us about Homo sapiens 30 years ago, 30,000 years ago, starting to produce art, not in one place, but almost everywhere, that attests to some stage in the biological evolution, a biological need. Now let's see what the great maestro of art has to say about that. And in a letter to his friend Max Liebermann, Picasso says, "Paintings are but research and experiment. I never do a painting as a work of art. All of them are researches." And to another colleague, André Warneau, he writes, "The painter's studio should be a laboratory. There one does not make art in the manner of a monkey one invents." Now, if this is the case, if these two giants, the artist and the painter, agree on one thing, that art and science are so intimately linked in our human nature, why does Idan talk about two worlds? Or are there two worlds? Why philosophers, artists, and painters, on numerous occasions, in numerous documents, link the two together, yet there is so little interaction, dialogue, between the two? That is something that I talk about, and maybe we can bring it up later in the discussion. Now, Picasso in 1907 produced this great piece of art, the Demoiselle d'Avignon. Now, if there is anything that demonstrates what Picasso told us just about painting being a result of research, it is this painting. I don't think that there is another painting in the history of art for which the artist has prepared himself so much as for this one. More than 600 sketches before that, more than 2 years studying African art in the exhibition at Trocadero, at that time going to Spain to study Iberian early historic art, and then he produces this. Now you look at this painting, what does it do to you? Now I'm asking you a question in aesthetics. I don't know what it does to you. I know what it does to me, and I tell you. I, for myself, can tell you that whenever I have the opportunity, I should not miss it, and I am around, I walk up to the fourth floor of the MoMA to stand before this painting. And I am not, when I stand then, I cannot say that it is beautiful. It is not beautiful. And aesthetics is not only about beauty. Aesthetics is also about irritation, about shocking, about all kinds of different feelings, surprise, tension. For me, this painting is an eruption of creativity. And it is not out of context. 1907, started in 1905. 1905, by the way, is in a sense a symbolic beginning of the whole field of neuroscience, because in 1905, Ramon Cajal gets the Nobel Prize for his what I call the atomic view of the brain. The brain is composed of cells. In 1905, Albert Einstein has his miraculous year. In those years, in every field of academic, intellectual, artistic endeavor, there are great breakthroughs, a great eruption of creativity. So, and this painting is the precursor of Cubism. Now, let me continue. Now, I already mentioned the word aesthetics. Now, traditionally, the study of how and how we respond, I shouldn't use here the word beauty, but I use the word beauty, but it is in a much broader sense. Today, as we heard from Idan Segev, it is time that we begin to ask meaningful questions about aesthetics. That is established in the University College of London, the Institute for Neuroaesthetic, and that institute every year organizes an international conference. And this is the poster for the third international conference, Emotions in Art and the Brain. And when you look at the program, you find lectures of titles as this one, The Neural Correlates of Love and Beauty, The Neurobiology of Creativity and Emotions, and numerous others. At all these conferences, the people who participate, who speak, are historians of art, historians of science, philosophers, and scientists in neurobiology. Now that's Idan Segev, myself, a few of our colleagues, had the idea to involve in this process about art and aesthetics in terms of what happens between our ears, to involve the artists themselves. And what I want to tell you now is what we have done in this context and why I think that this is useful. So, in 2004, we convened several of our colleagues with several artists in Kibbutz Kabri in the north, a retreat of 3 days, and Kibbutz Kabri has an artistic tradition. This is the kibbutz of Ori Reisman, of Yahya Shemi, and then for 3 days, we talked to each other. At the end of those 3 days, the artists who participate produced etchings. And I will show you what happened. But before I do that, I would like to say a few words of background. And I would like here to quote a critic of art of 1912 who said here, he wrote about Cubism. And Cubism was a great innovation. I mean, something completely new. And he wrote that the destination, the goal of Cubism, to give paintings its true aims, to reproduce objects as they are. Now, we don't see objects as they are, because we see objects under different conditions of illumination. We see objects from different distance, from different perspectives, that whenever we look at object, it is something else. But we have a certain capacity that is called the visual constancy. And I should say a few words about what that means, which is essential. And it is remarkable that this Jacques Rivière exactly grasped this idea in this statement here about cubism. You have to eliminate lighting, you have to eliminate perspective, you have looked for what is constant in the object. You see, when we say that a leaf is green, that is already doing something there, because whenever we look at that leaf, the physical color, the physical stimulation on our retina is very different. In dark, in this kind of lighting, in other kind of lighting, it's a different color. But we always know this is constant, this is green. And this visual constant, this quest for, and this concept of visual constancy is an essential feature of our visual system. And vision in that sense is an active process intended to extract from the ever-changing stimuli reaching the retina, the constant essential properties, which are necessary to identify and categorize objects. Another concept which is essential, absolutely necessary, is our ability to categorize. Now, you see, there is a famous Argentinian writer, Borges, has a very nice short story about a man who enters a forest, and the brain of that man lost the ability to categorize, and he sees trees. Now, there are no trees which are alike, but he cannot form the concept of a tree, therefore he has to remember every single tree. And of course, there is no way, there is no capacity there is in the memory, and that man goes crazy and dies finally. So the ability to categorize. Now, Zemir Zeki was already mentioned. This is the book that Idan mentioned about inner vision. And the whole message of that book is here, that most painters are, in a sense, neurologists, though in a different sense. They have experimented upon and without realizing have understood something about the organization of the visual brain. And this is that sense I meant, that Tibi Geva knows about the brain more than he thinks that he knows. And there are numerous examples. All painters are experimenting. Some of them in a way that is more obvious. And I will give you just a few examples before I tell you what happened in Capri. And for example, this thing here, extracting the features of a familiar face. Now, every Israeli here would recognize Sharon and Peres, and every citizen of planet Earth would recognize Albert Einstein. And this kind of experimenting, of looking for the essential, of looking for the ideal model of an object, so that we can then compare it with what is stored in our visual memory. And in our visual memory, there is no room for all the details in a face or in a familiar face. So what is the essential thing that what are the features that our brain, our visual system has extracted in order to store your faces, or my face for those of you who have seen me now for the first time, something happened in your brain, because tomorrow you will recognize it. Now, I don't think that him or anybody else knows the vast research that is now taking place at the forefront of this brain research about feature extraction, about categorization, but still artists play with it, and it is in that context that one can quote Henri Matisse, seeing is already a creative operation, one that demands an effort. Now let me give you another one. George Seurat, Encignac, the pointillists, They have written about it and experimented. They know nothing about the idea. They knew nothing about the ideas of receptive field that certain neurons, that our neurons also compose a picture from patches for different areas in space. And they experimented with the size of the dots, with the shape of the patches, with their density in order to produce that sensation. Now, very interesting is René Magritte. Now, René Magritte, you know, a scholar of vision, Richard Gregory, emphasized the point that vision is also has also a lot to do with hypothesis, with guessing, with assuming. You see, I am looking at all of you. I see your faces, I see your torso, I don't see your legs. But I guess that you have legs. Right? Exactly in that sense. But why I guess that you have legs? Because my recorded visual memory has been produced under normal visual conditions. And normal conditions combine faces and torsos with legs. And therefore, I am absolutely sure I know the shape of the tail of the fish. But here comes the big surprise. And this is how artists manipulate also. This is another, a remarkable example of this is not a pipe, but it was a pipe. And Magritte did not know, and I'm not aware that he knew, about the Stroop effect, with which Shaul Hochstein, one of our colleagues at the International's Interdisciplinary Center for Neural Computation, does all the time with his students, and how difficult it is when you are told very quickly, yeah, to tell the color of each of the words. Mm-hmm. And if I will let you try, you will see how difficult this may be. So now, after all this, let me show you what happened and tell you a little bit. Okay, so now I will do it very fast because I do want to respect the time limit. So I will show you what the artists have produced. One of the artists in Cabri was Jan Rauchberger. The Israelis know him, otherwise maybe not. And this he calls Mickey and Yaron, and this is a composition, his two sons. And it's very difficult to see how the essence, the essential elements of the two faces, but if you see the other etching, which he produced at the same time, and in the book, in the art book, they are side by side, you immediately see that this is the same composition of father and son. And now I shall very quickly flash what all the artists produced. Now let me tell you, I don't know if this was already a real dialogue in Capri. The two sides lectured to each other. I can, on every artist that he produced, I can somehow relate what was done, what he or she have done, with what happened there in Capri. But it was not an easy meeting. There were a lot of alienation and frustration and misunderstanding but maybe at the end of that, something new was created, and I'll do it very quickly, 10 seconds each, and I will summarize. And this is the binding of the book. But let me just maybe one example of where I could see there was a beginning of a dialogue. This symposium is also about creativity. Creativity was one subject. Chaim Sompolinski, Professor Chaim Sompolinski, is sitting here, and he's the director of our International Center for Neural Computation, talked there about creativity in the glasses, through the glasses of science. And he's a physicist, a colleague of mine. And he did not emphasize the connectivity, but he talked about something else. You see, in physics, we do study complex systems composed of many, many elements, which have complicated dynamics. And That dynamics is constrained. And there are all kinds of restraints that make it. Now, certain degrees of freedom are left. And dynamics with those degrees of freedom, evolving under constraints, produces unexpected new forms, shapes, behavior. This, in physics, we call emergent properties. The suggestion or the conjecture there was, it was not a theory of creativity. It was not a model of creativity. It was only a hint where we could look for answers and context of discussing them. I don't know if it is related to that or not, that Jan Rauchberger, at the same symposium, in his presentation, emphasized more than anybody else, in great details, his examples, the constraints that he imposes on himself during the work. Time, size, compositions, and many others. Since that meeting, I personally have been involved in an attempt to develop a meaningful dialogue with another artist, with Ofer Lalouche, and we have been doing it for several years now. And the challenge for me was to do it because Ofer Lalouche in Cabri claimed that art has a grammar, has a language, and that language has grammar. And I told him, if there is grammar, then there have to be rules of grammar. Please tell me what the set of rules are. And that is what we have been doing for 3 years now, to trying to work out the rules. I'm not sure that these rules are so universal. They are his own rules. But my main understanding is that they are constraints of discipline that he imposes on his work. And it is very interesting, very illuminating, very helpful in such a dialogue to understand such processes. And therefore, I am concluding. I know that Idan Segev had a dream. And I would like to wish him that his dream will be fulfilled. And his dream was that there will always be an artist in residence in our International Center for Neural Computation. And now I would like to take the dream over to the new center that we are dedicating this week. Thank you very much.
Okay, you ready? I'll be short. I was very moved by your talks and I decided to contribute. I will be short. I was very moved by the talks and I decided to contribute 130 million you need today. Okay, so I'm going to talk about my latest project, Macomb. It's a very good example, I think, for a process taken in different points in time. I did not direct this process, but looking back, I can point to some moments in time that are very significant in the creation of this piece. Macomb, just to let you know, I'll get back to it later, is a structure, construction, made out of stones from dismantled Israeli and Palestinian houses from different places like Jerusalem, Haifa, Hebron, Galilee, Jenin, and they come from different times as well, and put together into one place. And the decision was that this construction called Macomb means place, will undergo geographical changes. And with this in mind, I will start to describe the process leading to this project. And it actually begins, so I'm going to tell you a story. And maybe it'll be less academic. But the process starts many years ago. It starts at 4 BC. There was a king, King Herod, and he had to leave Jerusalem suddenly because a new king came. And he had to escape. And he took 5,000 people with him, including his family. and ran into the desert. And on the course of the road, his mother got badly injured. This is something I just heard yesterday. There was a... Anyway, he got to a certain point, and at that point a battle took place with the people who came after him. And finally, he won, but he got a bit overwhelmed and decided to die. And the people around him tried to convince him to actually remain in life. They wanted him to stay, and in a second thought he decided, okay, I'm going to not end my life at this point. I'm going to stay alive, but I would make this place my living place. And I will make this place my burial place. And, you know, Makom, I forgot to tell you, it's a good moment now, because the name is in Hebrew. Makom means place. You know, place is a consideration, it's a viewpoint of space. It's when you determine or decide or have an agreement about the marking of an area, and sometimes you even give it a name, and that name is that name of that place. And so did King Herod. He called it Herodion. And I was always, you know, of course he wanted to make a castle and he wanted to make it a palace, and he was known to be a paranoid. But I was very impressed by the gesture of an individual to make such a mark on a landscape. It was actually a no place, there was nothing there. And he made this artificial mountain in the desert. And I was wondering for years, could it be that he was actually an artist? And years later, so this was 4 BC, and I continue with my process. Years later, let's see. Years later, I went there. For me, it was the last point I could reach before it was a boulder. And I was standing on the top of Herodion, and I was looking at this landscape that continued, which I could not reach, this familiar and forbidden landscape. And I saw those structures in the distance. I saw this house, specifically this one, which was this perfect cube, and so perfect, so impossibly perfect. And I kept going there again and again and again. There is always this again and again and again, like Tibi told you, again and again and again with the canvas. I went to this place again and again and again for a few years, actually. Like, wanted to investigate something which I didn't exactly verbalize to myself. It became my laboratory, if you wish. It also became probably the moment of the beginning of the ending of my marriage. And the question was, so why do we go there again in the weekend? And where are we going? And I said, we go to Herodion. And then he would ask me, why are we going again? But we've been there last weekend. And I said, I need to look at it again. And I need to take another picture. And I wonder, when I'm looking, do you think there is anybody out there? How do I go forward? With all my knowledge of technology. What? Ravi? My 20 שניות? So, okay, I'll continue. I wouldn't waste the time. So a few years later, on my way to the Dead Sea, I found another house, another structure, another makom, if you wish. And, Ravi? Okay, so I saw this house in the desert. This is just to contradict the reputation that I have that I'm a very technological artist. And anyway, I went to the desert, on the way to the desert in the Dead Sea, and I saw another house, and that house was very isolated, and it reminded me of a house which I used to draw as a child, or a house that any child would draw. And there was something again about it that was so simple and so perfect, and so you can imagine it now. Use your imagination. So simple and perfect. Stay around. And again, you know, something, I said it's like a house for me dictionary. It's a terminology that I use often. We have a problem, huh? Maybe the untouching the screen is a problem. So like a house in a dictionary, but you know in the dictionary, under the definition of a house, it says it's a place that is linked to one site. And this house, as I kept going there again and again, and this is again, few years of going to the same site, taking another picture and another picture, another picture of the same house, and it becomes a series that demonstrates a change that accumulates. Okay. And you know, when you accumulate another house and another house and another house, it could be any house anywhere. Later on, I always start with reality. I'm always recording or collecting things from reality. I will move to another area that would connect in the end, to working with people. I went to Russia and I filmed 50 people in the age of 50. I also went to Romania and I filmed 50 people in the age of 50. And I filmed 50, never mind, I filmed 50 people in the age of 50 in Israel. So it could be anybody, anywhere. My desire was to create a total environment in a cubic space again, in a room, to make a text, a wall text with no beginning and no end, an unresolved text about humanity. Project in stone is stretching a timeline back to the beginning of text, to the beginning of writings. I'm using those lines and rows of people. It could be anybody, anywhere. And mostly it's some kind of a marriage between the light photons and some substance. Notebooks, but most of the project was this marriage between this non-material light and the stone. And again, the time is not specific and the text is not specific, and it's again an unresolved text, and it's mostly some kind of a demonstration or evidence to the human desire to communicate, ongoing desire to communicate, and the desire to leave a mark, on a stone. And there's also the notion of archaeology, like looking for some kind of footnotes in the past to what is going on and still going on, to some continuous timeline. And this was like an archaeological dig where you could stand from above looking down. So I go back to Makom. There are two projects Makom, and as I told you, the stones came from different places, and some houses were dismantled many years ago, and some more recent. And there are many reasons for these houses to be deconstructed or destroyed. Of course, when I talk about Israelis and Palestinians, some politics comes to mind, and rightly so, but it's not always because of political reasons that they were dismantled. However, I did want to make a project bringing those together, and to do so with a team of Israelis and Palestinians. And the stones came in different, different styles of carving, and it's nuances, but they mean a lot when you try to build something together. And they're also in different sizes, and they're first thing that I was told that we need to cut all the stones to the same size. If you buy the stonemason, if you want to put it together, you look everywhere, it's all, even in Lego, in any construction, they have to be the same size. And that was the first decision, not to change or cut the stones, but to try to find a way to put them together, which again became almost like an archaeological process of searching through piles and piles of stones to find the right stone to fit. There was no clear idea in my mind of what would be the final form of this this project. And maybe there was an idea, but it was buried from 4 BC, which I forgot about. היום בניו יורק זה בדרך לטרון. It started in the field of my house in Latrun Road, and as I told you, I wanted this place, which is this piece, Makom, which is a collage of places, collage of times, collage of biographies. You know, it has particles of different realities, and I wanted it all together to undergo geographical changes. And if it took many, many months to put together, you know, it's not Photoshop. It was very, very difficult because there were always different decisions that I made about stones that were already lifted up, and some of them were near 100 kilos or so. And so in order to move it elsewhere, I needed to mark the stones, you know, and that comes again to the old notion of marking a stone and numbering a stone. What you see there is the search to find always the right stone to fit the role, like a very heavy Sudoku. And I did like the physicality of it, especially watching it from a distance. And that, you know, marking of the stone, you know, each stone suddenly got its identity, an undecipherable identity. And it also looked like some kind of an index. I like the term index since I started to work with scientists. To move elsewhere, all these places, and 2 days later, this process started. You know, these stones already went through construction and deconstruction and destruction, and so it's a very important part of it. Now it became like pulling teeth out of the mouth, and each stone is. It was just a stone, now they are precious stones, because if one gets broken or so, you know, we cannot cut another one to the size, and we have to start looking through piles again. There is something very haunting, as someone who likes to create, there is something very haunting in the destruction of something. In the moment of when you start to watch the thing deteriorate, when you look at the leftovers, and the search for, you know, the last remaining pieces. It always reminds me of some kind of archaeology or some kind of a catastrophical site. I forgot to tell you it was 60 tons.
Since we are running so late, I suggest to turn straight and directly to you, you know, to hear your remarks, comments, and questions. So please. Can you stand up when you...
Yes.
Then we can direct the microphone to you.
Can I listen? Okay. Hello, my name is Doron Livne. I've been teaching at the Bezalel Academy of Art for about 25 years or more. And I think that finally I've gotten an answer to a very big problem which I had. When Idan described the Oliver Sacks experiment with a drawing, when his cortex was stimulated, and then suddenly he could draw like Leonardo da Vinci, I think, Eureka, we have the answer to the whole like question of art education in particular and education in general. Well, this is a question which I have to deal with, and I put it to you. Another thought which I had is that is about the whole concept of creativity. When God created man in his own image and likeness, did he create another version of God, a version of God, or an extension of God, or did he create something totally different? And I think both answers are true. It's just a matter of the story that you tell to yourself. The story of science, or the story of art, or in Kant's, Immanuel Kant's term, the story of nature, or the story of freedom. This was the terms of Immanuel Kant, the principle of nature, or principle of freedom. Well, I think I won't say any more now. I just put these ideas as questions to deal with. Thank you.
My name is Menachem Tzur, I'm a composer, and I just want to make it known to this panel that we composers think alike, just the same as all other creative people think in terms of every composition is also an experiment. We regard our table, our desk, as a laboratory in which you imagine acoustical impressions and how they talk to each other, all the components, all the parameters of the piece. So we construct against the background of some established ideas of people what music is. You are experimenting and you raise questions. In other words, a piece of music that does not have, as Professor Woodford said, something irritating, not in a sense of a bad irritation, but a question, something that raises a question, raises a problem, sometimes leaves it hung in the air, sometimes resolves it temporarily, but altogether a piece that does not have that question, that does not have that music as an experience, for me, it's not a work of art, and in that light, I am educate my students, the Academy of Music in Jerusalem.
Came today is because I have that schizophrenic, not really schizophrenic, just kidding, mind where I'm very strongly right brain and very strongly left brain. So I'm part business person and part in the artistic world. And I'm extremely interested in the whole area of the connection between the brain and creativity. My most recent book that I read was Daniel Pink's book, A Whole New Mind, which unfortunately Steinmetzky does not yet carry, even though I tried to convince them to carry it. discussing the relationship between the scientific left brain world that and how we're moving into the right brain world of where a lot of creativity is going to be necessary for the marketplace, not just for the artists. So I see a lot of promise for this department, and I would like to hear more about, on a day like today, not just the visual arts represented, which were very interesting, but also, for example, like music represented, music in the brain, something about what is going on in the mind of a musician as opposed to a non-musician. I would have liked to see a visual artist, let's say somebody who deals with photographs, illustrations, television, because all of these things are really communicating to us in some way. And one of the things that I'm really interested in pursuing is an understanding of, you know, so first of all, what's going on in the mind of a creative person versus a non-creative person or a less creative person? Another thing that I'd like to understand is how can we stimulate creativity in the less creative people, and how can we sort of give parameters to creativity so that people have more ability to be flexible between both universes, so that, you know, the artists are not just in the art realm and the non-artists are not exclusively in the non-artistic realm. I actually work with a book called The Artist's Way, which is a creativity development course and manual. And again, I think that there are tremendous breakthroughs taking place in this very arena of creativity in the brain that I'd really like to be able to hear more about, see more developed, and feel like I can come to a place like this and really be stimulated. So.
Hi, my name is Maya, and I'm a student here at the University in Cognitive Sciences. Through the discussion, I saw that both artists and scientists are using exactly the same words to explain what they're going through, whether it's a mental space or a metaphor or experience or consciousness. We're all talking about the exact same thing, and it's something that I've been fighting in the system. And I really want to understand how someone like Michal Rovner and someone like Idan Segev can really work together into something meaningful that will give both sides an advantage, and not only experimental designs as I'm doing right now, which are very kind of squared.
I think my name is Dalia Cohen from the musicology department, but I'm also interested in relationship between arts and here this is the subject and the relationship to our cognitive activity. So I think that all of them somehow they did not mention it about the accepting receiving experiences from rules of organizations in all the arts, especially in music. And the question, what are the principles of these rules? Because how come that here we organize the forms and colors, and what we organize in music is more complicated, but it's something fantastic that we can be we can enjoy suffering and so, because it's some kind of sublimation. It's all getting experience from rules of organization, what Hanoch just mentioned. And I think that we should look, and I believe beside all kinds of association, that in music especially it comes to an extreme that it's only from the rules of from the rules of organization, in contrast to literature, that there are interference of the semantic, yes, but also the rules are very important, and I think we should do, we can compare, for instance, if I should think, what is the last, from our last lecture, what are the principles here, and you can compare it also to some kind of music. It depends everywhere, you have different aesthetic ideals, and I think that we should look more about, if we are thinking about relationship to brain activity, really to see this artistic as a cognitive activity. And of course, we did a lot of experiments I can't give a lecture, but there's a lot of mathematical, sometimes in some of the music, mathematical ability that you need in order to absorb.
Thank you very much. I suggest that we start answering the questions. So, would like to start? Yeah.
I don't remember all the questions, but let me say just on a few. First of all, about I think your question about left brain, right brain. We don't use these terms anymore. In neuroscience, there is no left brain, right brain anymore. There are no regions in the brains that are not connected to other regions, so there is no one capability on one side and another capability on another side. It's, as I said, connected very, very heavily. So anything that you have at this moment at your right brain, within a few milliseconds, already appears in other regions and activates the whole brain. That's one scientific comment. The other comment is that the need, and that's something fundamental that we have to try to get rid of it, that's I think what we are trying to say here, is this need to dichotomize things. So there is right, left, good or evil, right or wrong, left or right, and so forth. We don't have art and science. We don't want these distinctions anymore. We want to break this distinction. And one way to do it, there are some ideas, and I don't want to elaborate on that, but one idea, one wrong that we are doing is that the fact that when a child is born, at the moment he's born, he already knows that there is science museum there and art museum there. So they are not connected. It's not in the same place. It must be something different. So one suggestion is to have a new museum in Jerusalem. It will be called Ars Museum. Museum of Art. Museum of Art and Science. I know. Okay, so this was a suggestion joke. But serious joke. So that's a comment about that. Now, I think the most difficult question for me was asked here about how to really functionally work together, that it would be really fundamentally creative. How do we create this culture? And this is difficult, and I don't really know how to do it, so that the artists and scientists will really work and benefit in the scientific realm and also the artistic realm, in the new arts realm. How to do it correctly, I don't really know. But one thing I am sure, that we should interact physically on a daily basis. In our center, for example, we have physicists, psychologists, neurologists, neurobiologists, even philosophers working together. And what will come of it, it's not clear, I cannot envision, but I know that if we want to work together, we'll remain in the old dichotomized realm. And the brain is not dichotomized. It does create art and science. So we have to understand it as a whole. So we have to start to work together. From this, we'll have more things. Let me...
I would begin by responding to Maya's question or challenge or query. And I would not take it to the extreme that it is. That, you know, you have to do your things, artists have to do your things. I don't know. Don't spend the whole day together, because then things will be... it is true. You see, the message that I wanted to carry across, that there is a lot in common, because both functions create models of the world, acquire knowledge about the world, and both use the mechanisms of the brain, right? So this is common. But from here, everything else is a little different. Now, the reason that I emphasize this importance of dialogue pursuing. I hope that some of the artists, at least, now I'm confident that experiment with perception all the time, that they have something, some knowledge about the brain, because how they experiment, then they are happy. And then if other people are happy, that they understood something about their brain and other people's brain. And my question is if they can verbalize, if they can use their introspection and put in words the decision process. What happens to them when they are doing? I don't know yet, I don't know, how this will connect to actual mechanisms. Let me give you an example. I mentioned that I've been doing it for several years now with Ofer Lelouch, a painter, a sculptor. And I'm really fascinated by how much contemplation, decision, back and forth, goes into a decision whether he will make it a horizontal frame or a vertical frame before he decides to paint something, and this is the kind of constraint that he immediately imposes himself in, and this sets a whole rule, a whole set of rules, because in his mind, vertical frame is masculinity and power and this is a very different mood. And these kinds of insight, or these kinds of verbalizing